Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Thanks be to God. Happy Easter. It is wonderful to see all of you. My goodness, what a joy to gather together after such a long period of time apart. I know we've done a handful of services outdoors, but certainly nothing like this. Certainly not Easter Sunday. Certainly not in the parking lot of the high school. But what a joy. Our God is faithful to meet us everywhere and anywhere. For our God in Jesus Christ lives. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you. It took a genuine army of volunteers to pull this together, from the parking attendants to the folks doing the sound and behind the scene logistics and the ushers and greeters and all the supplies, the setting up of all of this, the ensuring all of this was just right, the working with the high school to help secure this. Thank you. It took a real monumental effort to sort of bring all that we know about church into this space. But then as I was walking around just before the service, someone said, "Tailgating for church. You know, this has legs. This has a future." I appreciate y'all being here. I appreciate your flexibility, your sense of humor. We're, of course, competing with the birds, the planes, the motorcycles, but we are going to have our Easter service. Hopefully, as you came in, ushers and greeters gave you a bulletin and a little cup for communion for later in this service. If you don't have those, kind of look around for one of the ushers and greeters who is standing towards the back area and make sure you can get those. If you are listening by way of radio, you should know 87.9 FM is the station. If for some reason you're in the middle of the service and you need to run back to your car and you want to take it in from there, 87.9. Lilies, thank you for those who gave lilies for our 8:30 service in the sanctuary, and of course, live stream there, and then here. If you purchase lilies and you want to take that with you, absolutely. You can come up after this service and get your lilies, or if you don't end up doing it here, of course, you can grab yours during the weekday in the sanctuary at the church. A couple other things to know before we continue in worship. Know that towards the way back of this parking lot, there are some families and kids, and they're hanging out in this fun kid area. If you need a little space to be towards the back and hang, it's next to the porta potties, which if you need that, we've got that as well, and that is at the back of the lot. Last thing to note, next week, April 11th, is we're going to have a live stream service of worship. It's our FPC Kids Sunday. Our kids have been working for a while to put together all these different recordings and creativity into a service at 11 a.m., very unique. Looking forward to that. And then later this week, we're really excited. We'll have an announcement coming out about gathering again in person in our building for both of our services in the next month. And so we're excited to be able to do that in early May and bringing that all together. Some of this has to do with our timeline with getting that building repaired after the winter storms, but it's coming together. Thank you also to all who took the survey and gave us a lot of input and helpful guidance as we think through how to do this well and wisely. But we're looking forward to that announcement yet this week. Let us continue now in worshiping the living, risen Jesus Christ, who is faithfully in our midst this day.
Lord, morning. I cannot tell you how honored I am to be with you all this morning helping to lead in worship. I would like to have you join now in the call to worship. Please rise. Jesus Christ, in your triumph over the grave and your resurrection from death, the heavens and earth rejoice. We praise you, O God, for you have made us victorious over sin. On the mountain of the Lord, all people will feast and all wine shall be poured. We praise you, O God, for you have prepared a table before us and our cups overflow. The Lord has swallowed up death forever. The Lord has wiped away the tears from all faces. We praise you, O God, for you have brought us from death to life. The disgrace of God's people has been taken away from the earth because the Lord has spoken. We praise you, O God, for you have given us joy and gladness. Confession, followed by your own silent prayers of confession. Let us pray. Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, we rejoice for you, O Lord, our King. It is in our hearts and on our tongues that we confess your Lordship and we commit to your graces our shortcomings and sin, failures and fears, our divisions and discord, all of us that has not lived fully and joyfully in your way of life and life eternal. Jesus Christ is risen today. He has triumphed over the power of sin and death. In him we are the forgiven, reconciled, and beloved family of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
The first reading this morning comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. Listen now for the word of God. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Mention at the outsets of the announcements, we do invite you to sign in and let us know you're here, even if whether you do it in the service or just at the service. As simple as going to our worship service, fbcgeorgetown.org, and going click on like up as this little form that just lets you fill in, hey, name, and lets us know you're here. If you're new or you're visiting, you put in email or phone if you want follow-up. But virtual sign-in can be done by just going to our website at some point. Come alongside us for worship today. The second reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians is one of Paul's letters that's fairly well known. If you're around the Bible some, you've heard some of the more famous scriptures and verses come from there. Perhaps most famously at weddings, 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient. Love is kind. The crescendo is 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Found issue? Switch to Chris. I hear me. I can hear through speak, but you want to switch to Christina's? Okay.
get there in a moment.
Check, 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 check. Yes, yes, yes. Okay, we're back. We're back in action. Okay. As maybe some of you heard Jamie say from the front, now's a really good time to sign in. We're kind of getting ourselves back together here. 1 Corinthians. A lot of famous verses, but the great crescendo, the high point, the thing that Paul really wants to ultimately get out and be clear about. Let me bring this a little closer to my face to help with the wind. Is what we have here in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 11. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you have received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you've believed in vain. For what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was within me. Whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you have believed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Did any of you follow that story about Ever Given? That massive cargo ship carrying billions of dollars worth of goods that for six consecutive days in the middle of March was stuck sideways in the narrow Suez Canal. Do you know this story? Yeah, okay, few. As you probably saw, they brought out some excavators to come alongside the banks of the canal to kind of try to dig up the sand and the dirt on either end of the cargo ship to loose it up. And they had tugboats out there, right, pulling on this massive cargo ship to get it loose. Well, at some point in this process, someone took a photo of the front of this massive ship banked in on the side of the Suez, right? And then underneath it, like a thumbnail, is this little excavator trying to dig some dirt to free this massive cargo ship. Well, the photo got out and the internet went bonkers with memes about that photo, right? One person put on top of the massive cargo boat, my tasks, and then right on top of the little excavator, me, dutifully chopping away at my tasks. Another put on the image of the boat, the crushing despair of everything from this past year. And then the excavator, you, doing your very best. Another, kind of in a similar vein, my mental health during a pandemic. And then the little excavator reads, going for a walk at lunchtime. These and similar memes became wildly popular with people of all backgrounds and all over the world, actually. Time and again, there was really this widely shared sense when people saw this particular photo where they went, isn't that so true? I mean, isn't that just like life? This impossibly big challenge, this big weight, this big thing, and then us doing our little part to make a difference. And the thing that struck me about so many of these memes, if you saw them or you can look them up later, is they're really funny. They make you laugh out loud when you see people's creativity. But a lot of the humor is only understood and gotten if you can appreciate that there's a lament that they're riffing off of. There's a lament in the undertone of it all. the humor is found in this painful truth that, that people recognize, you know what, there really are some big and huge and impossible dilemmas in our world and in our lives. And our response really can and often does feel so small or perhaps even futile. The humor, I think, carried with it this almost unspoken, uncomfortable question. Does anything we do really, ultimately, make a difference? When you look at the writings of the Apostle Paul, it is clear that when he looks out upon this world, what he sees, among other things, is this massive ship of sin and death that has thwarted and blocked and defeated humanity generation after generation. No matter how ingenious our excavators, no matter how well-intended our tugboats, right? We have tried to budge that ship through education, legislation, scientific advances, moral exhortation, and more, and still there sits that ship. But now, do you recall how Ever Given eventually, ultimately got free? The essential thing that made that whole thing work was the fact that on Monday, March 22nd, there was a full moon. And so this extremely high tide of water came through the Suez Canal and came underneath Ever Given and lifted it just enough to get it up off of the banks and free it. In other words, the most fundamental reason this impossibly big ship moved was because of something entirely beyond human control. The moon shone, the waters rose, pure gift of creation. When Paul looks upon this massive ship of sin and death, what he declares in 1 Corinthians 15 is that the ship has been dislodged by the pure gift of Jesus Christ. He says that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, which is to say, Christ has taken the sins of the world upon himself. Christ has taken the reality of death upon himself. Christ has risen from the grave, and so it is Christ who has dislodged and overcome their power. Yes, we still know the realities of sin and death in this world, but at a fundamental level, what we proclaim is that the light has shone in the darkness, the living water has risen, and this has inaugurated a new heavens and a new earth, as Scripture puts it, where sin and death do not hold final sway, do not hold full sway. In Christ and with Christ, life and life eternal are the reality that is ours by grace this day, pure gift. I love that boat, that ship, it is named Ever Given. What a perfect way to underscore that our ever given reality in Jesus Christ is one where the boat is fundamentally dislodged, pure gift. Because if we know that that is our ever given, constant, continual reality, it changes everything, doesn't it? Right? If you're an excavator, for instance, you spend your days getting your hands and your heart dirty in the trying realities of relationships, or maybe in politics, or teaching kids of all temperaments and interests and abilities, or you spend your days getting your hands and hearts dirty, trying to move the ball forward on a just cause, a good cause, or forgiving another, or caring for patients amid all kinds of complications, or caring for the widow or the orphan, or the foreigner, or the poor. If you spend your days as an excavator, doesn't it make all the difference in the world if you know that the light has shined, the waters have risen, and the boat is dislodged? For then we're confident that though, yes, this work is messy, this work is slow, this work is full of trial and heartache and pain, it is not work that is in vain. Right? Sin will not have the final say in your interior work or exterior work. Neither will death triumph, not ultimately, for the boat will move. The boat is moving. And if you're a tugboat, right, you're one who spends your days trying to pull away from or know a new freedom from certain failings, certain shortcomings, certain addictions. You spend your day pulling against certain forms of injustice or apathy or callousness or greed or judgmentalism. You spend your day so that you might pull a new openness, a new space of forgiveness, a new freedom, a new space for the overlooked or the underappreciated. You spend your days trying to open that kind of life-giving space in your life, around your life, in others. If you spend your days as a tugboat, doesn't it make all the difference in the world if you know the light has shone, the waters have risen, and the tugboat or the ship is fundamentally dislodged? Doesn't it make all the difference to know that, yes, this is weighty work, tiring work, exasperating work at times, but it's not in vain? Fundamentally, this work shall not be lodged in sin, and death shall not prevail, not ultimately. That boat has moved. That boat is moving. This really is the logic of Paul's entire argument in 1 Corinthians 15. He spends 57 of 58 verses in chapter 15 just articulating the depths of this basic truth that Jesus is risen from the grave. There is a new heavens and a new earth in which the powers of sin and death no longer hold a fundamental anchoring sway. And after making that abundantly clear, that's our fundamental reality in our lives, around our lives, and throughout all creation, both now and forevermore, Paul tells the church this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, the very last verse. Therefore, in light of this new reality I've just named that Jesus Christ has given us by grace, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your work in the Lord is not in vain. The ship will move. The ship is moving. As exciting and joyful as it is for us to gather together on this Easter morning, I remain mindful that those ship and excavator memes make it clear also that for many, there is this day, this underlying season and reality of lament. This past year in particular has made it clear just how divided we can be, just how precarious our jobs can be, just how violent we can be, just how uncertain the future of our country, or just how uncertain the future shape of the church in America. And then, of course, we are all carrying with us any variety of personal and familial challenges layered in right amidst all of that. And what we proclaim on Easter Sunday is then, I think, in fact, quite urgent and needful. For we proclaim that, yes, the ship is real. In fact, the ship is absolutely huge. And the ship has been dislodged at its most fundamental point. In Christ Jesus, the powers of sin and death are no longer fundamentally entrenched. And we, the Church of Jesus Christ, we give witness to this hope. We give witness to the fact that Jesus is risen and alive, quite simply by giving ourselves fully to the digging and the pulling, the working and the praying. And we do so with this unyielding joy, this genuine hope. For we are held in this fundamental conviction, both now and forever, that the light is shining in the darkness, the waters of life are rising, and the captives have been set free. Jesus Christ is risen indeed. Thanks be to God. It seems particularly timely that we could gather this Sunday, Easter Sunday, speaking of the hope and the joy that we have, and then get to celebrate and participate in the Lord's Supper. Because this is one of the more fundamental ways that we are nourished upon the living, risen Jesus Christ. His presence, His life, His hope. The Holy Spirit gathers us here, calls us here, makes known our forgiveness, feeds us here, and then sends us from here, empowered to do the digging and the pulling, the working and the praying. What a joy it is that we can feed upon this hope, this love, the risen truth of our Savior together as the family of God. I invite you to have your cups prepared for just in a little bit after the great prayer of thanksgiving and then into the Lord's Prayer. I will offer the words of institution and after our elements of cup and bread. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. With joy we give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, source of all life and love, that we live in your world, that you are always creating and sustaining it by your power, and that you have so made us that we can know and love you, trust and serve you. We give you thanks that you love the world so much that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who has faith in him may not die but have eternal life. We thank you that Jesus was born among us, that he lived our common life on earth, that he suffered and died for us, that he rose again, and that he is always present through the Holy Spirit. We thank you that we can live in faith, that your kingdom will come, and that in life and in death and beyond death, you are with us. Therefore, with all the company of heaven and with all your people, in all places and all times, we proclaim the greatness, your greatness, and in our work we witness to your hope. Holy Lord God, by what we do here in remembrance of Christ, we celebrate his perfect sacrifice on the cross and his glorious resurrection and ascension. We declare that he is Lord of all, and we prepare for his coming kingdom. We pray that through your Holy Spirit, this bread may be for us the body of Christ and this wine the blood of Christ. As we eat and as we drink at his command, unite us to Christ as one body in him, and give us strength to serve you in this world with hope and with joy. And now we join together in one voice, offering the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took it, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me. The Apostle Paul goes on to tell us that as often as we eat of this bread and we drink of this cup, we proclaim our Lord's saving death until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God, and you are invited. I invite you to first take the bread. The body of Christ broken for you. Take and eat. Now the cup. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Let us pray. Gracious God, what a joy it is to gather as your visible church, united in this table, not because we are worthy, but because you have called us, and you've called us, forgiven us, and made us sisters and brothers alongside one another. We give thanks that we can be nourished upon your living, risen presence this day. And we ask now that you'd send us boldly from this place by the power of your Spirit, that our lives and our work might proclaim a living hope, for you are risen indeed. Amen. In response to the good news of Jesus Christ, we offer our lives in any countless number of ways. Our digging and our polling, our praying and our working, and the manner we steward our financial resources and offer those in contribution to God's work, God's kingdom work in this world. If you're being led to make a financial contribution as you discern the ways God is calling you to give, know you can always do that online on our website, a check in the mail to the church, or at the end of the service, if you want to come up to the offering box here at the front and place something in there, you are welcome to do that as well. I invite you to continue in prayerful reflection as you discern how the Holy Spirit is leading you.
Blessings are mine with 10.
Gracious God, we rejoice that your glory has dawned upon us and brought us to this day of resurrection. We rejoice that the grave could not hold your Son. He has conquered the powers of sin and death and risen to rule over all of creation. We praise you that you have summoned us to follow you into new life with joy and gladness. By your Spirit, may we do just that, and may this offering be an expression of our grateful following as you continue to renew and remake us and this world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, we got sun and rain and wind and planes and birds and Jesus. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. The light has shone in the darkness, and the living water is rising, and the ship has been dislodged. In Christ Jesus, sin and death no longer hold final and full sway. Life and life eternal is our gift. We witness to the gift of this joy and this hope by going forth as diggers, as excavators, as tugboats, as prayers, as workers, who do that work with a confidence and with a joy because we know we have this hope. And as you go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit hold you, keep you, empower you, strengthen you, lead you, encourage you this day and always. Amen.